Today's video is sponsored by Trifectura Home Products, your source for hardware, housewares, cleaning products, and office supplies. For some reason, the good folks at Trifectura didn't give me a product to test for you this time around.
Yes.
But I do want to tell you about the new Trident Rewards program. Sign up today and you'll receive a free monthly newsletter full of tips and tricks to get on the pathway towards a less terrible you, as well as that all-important 3% discount. Sign up today using special offer code FRAME24, all one word, to get $100 off your first quarterly membership. After that, each quarterly membership costs just a little bit more than the trial membership without the discount. It's easy to sign up. Just go to trifectorahomeproducts.com and start on the path towards a less terrible you through the power of buying stuff. You know, capitalism. Anyway, now that that's taken care of, welcome to Frame 24, the show that unashamedly alters its plans at the last minute to compensate for its screw-ups. Orson Welles once called filmmaking the biggest electric train set a boy ever had. I think that's an apt metaphor for his approach to cinema, full of creative energy and enthusiasm. Welles was a director who never lost his sense of play. And I think the same could also be said for today's subject, director Fritz Lang. From his use of awe-inspiring special effects to dynamic editing and narrative techniques, Lang was always pushing the limits of the possible, exploring what this wonderful toy of cinema could do.
How do you like this, big shot?
Born in Vienna in 1890, Lang studied civil engineering and art before joining the Austrian army to fight in the First World War. After his discharge in 1918, he went to work as a writer at Decla Film in Berlin, then later as a writer and director at UFA and at Nero Film. And it was here that he made many of the movies that cemented his legacy. But then in 1933, Adolf Hitler became Chancellor of Germany. Lang, fed up with Nazi censorship and fearing persecution because of his Jewish heritage, left the country for France, then the UK, and finally America. He continued making films in Hollywood until his retirement in 1960, and although most critics agree that Lang's American films lack the creative drive of his earlier works, many of them, especially early in his Hollywood career, retain his distinctive and playful style. From the beginning, Lang was indebted to the German expressionist cinema of the 1910s and early 20s. Films like The Cabinet of Dr. Caligari used unrealistic set design, stark lighting, and special effects to create not a photographic reality, but a subjective view of the world, filtered through the minds of the characters.
Oh Jesus, not that crap again!
Lang applied many of these same tools to his movies, adding depth to what might otherwise have been straightforward genre films and elevating them into classics. Consider 1927's Metropolis with its multiple exposures, stop animation, and pioneering use of the Schuftan process, which used mirrors to combine actors, partial sets, and scale models seamlessly in camera. Also, Metropolis just feels like an expressionist film, with its melodramatic story, psychologically fragile characters, and an emphasis on emotion and subjectivity. Another hallmark of Lang's silent films was his use of cutaways between intertitles. Instead of watching two characters discuss events happening at another location, we actually travel to that other location and watch it unfolding, all within the context of their conversation. With the coming of synchronized sound, Lang's creativity exploded. His intertitle sandwich technique would carry over into audible dialogue, with a conversation beginning in one scene and then continuing into the next, sometimes even between different characters. Other sounds also overlap, tying the soundtrack together in the same way that his frequent dissolves meld the visuals into a unified whole. Each scene becomes inextricably linked with what came before and what follows. This gives Lang's films a unique sense of drive, with each scene tumbling along in a flood of narrative urgency, until it doesn't. Lang brought these same techniques to bear on his American films as well. Consider this scene from 1936's Fury. Note how the score becomes diegetic sound as the scene transitions. And then when Sylvia Sidney walks to the radio and turns the knob, a new song begins. At first, we're not clear. Did she just change the station or turn off the radio? But then she moves to the window and we discover the source of this new music. The singing neighbor. It's just one of a series of brilliant, ambiguous moments that Lang sprinkles throughout Fury, the tale of false assumptions, lies, and misdirection. But for me, Lang did it all best with his first sound picture, M, from 1931. The story of a madman preying on the children of Berlin and the efforts by both the police and the Berlin crime syndicate to capture him. M is incontrovertibly one of the greatest films ever made. Peter Lorre bursts onto the scene here in his first starring role as Hans Beckert, the terrifying yet sympathetic killer, driven by a compulsion he cannot resist, revolted by his own misdeeds. The atmospheric lighting forms the bridge between expressionism and what would eventually evolve into film noir. And I love the set design, especially the storage area where Beckert crouches, panting like a caged animal, awaiting the inevitable. But it's the film's soundscape that impresses me the most. Beckert is linked with, and later identified by, his compulsive whistling of Edvard Grieg's In the Hall of the Mountain King. Silence is used to build suspense, or heighten the agony of the empty places where little Elsie Beckman should be. Her murder scene, in fact, is a masterclass in implication. There's no sound except the forlorn cries of her mother. There's no blood, only an empty chair, a tumbling ball, a lost balloon. There's no need for anything else. There's nothing more to say. In contrast, the sequence which may be M's greatest claim to fame is pretty dialogue-heavy. An angry public official calls the police commissioner and demands to know why the cops haven't caught this guy yet. The commissioner then explains all the work his department is doing to solve the case, and as he does, we see those same steps in the investigation being carried out on screen. This seems pretty normal for us today. I mean, think of the planning montage of every heist movie you've ever seen. But at the time, this was revolutionary. You have to remember the jazz singer had only been released 4 years before, and most talkies were still being produced with the idea that just seeing people's mouths move and words come out of them was a novelty. It's like no one had figured out that dialogue could function dynamically with the projected image to propel the plot forward. And if I'm overstating that, I hope someone will correct me down in the comments. Within M itself, the layering of sounds and visuals invests what would otherwise be a rather tedious first half with energy, pulling us eagerly toward the exciting, heart-wrenching, and terrifying conclusion. Well, almost conclusion. The story has a really satisfying story arc, beginning, middle, end. But the actual end of the movie, there's a coda. And that coda, I swear to you, is...
Oh, won't somebody please think of the children?
What the fuck, Fritz? You're making one of the greatest movies in the history of German cinema, and you end it with a goddamn PSA? Are you kidding me? That frustrating ending aside, M is Fritz Lang at the absolute height of his powers as a director. A near-perfect film. This should be watched again and again, But as with all the best movies, its ultimate lesson is not which techniques do I use to achieve these specific results. It's not like we're putting together a bookcase. There's not just one set of instructions to follow. The most important lesson that this, or any other Fritz Lang movie teaches us, is to go out and make movies.
Oh boy, what a shot this is.
Try new things. Some of them won't work. Try them again. Try something different. Keep pushing the limits of what you think you can do with this marvelous toy we call cinema. Play. Hey, film dorks. Hope you enjoyed my overview of Fritz Lang's style and my review of my favorite one of his movies. Which one is your favorite? Let me know in the comments down below, and I will see you on the flip side.